Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. When it comes to committing crimes, no one does it better than corporate America. But unlike massive corporations, if a person were to break the law, they'd actually spend some time in prison. And the United States has already experienced more than 50 mass shootings so far this year. So why is the media being so silent about this issue? That's what's coming up. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
Before we begin tonight, I wanted to take a few minutes to talk about the importance of free speech TV. We're kicking off our first pledge drive of the year today, and this year is unlike any other we've ever faced. We're in the middle of a heated presidential race with a group of radical extremists on the Republican side and a Democratic establishment on the other that wants to move the party further to the right. As a matter of fact, just last week, Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz, the chair of the Democratic National Committee, announced that she's going to be co-sponsoring legislation that would gut the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau's ability to regulate predatory payday lenders. This is the woman that's leading the Democratic Party, and she wants to gut something that Senator Elizabeth Warren put in place to protect consumers. But did you hear about that story in the corporate media? No, you didn't. And that's because the corporate media relies on advertisers and board members to dictate what they can and can't say on the air. Here at Free Speech TV, we don't have advertisers, we don't have shareholders, and we don't filter our stories to spare the feelings of corporate America. Our loyalty is to you, our viewers, and you're the ones who keep Free Speech TV alive. For the last 12 months, MSNBC, the supposed liberal news outlet, has been purging some of their more progressive hosts and personalities from the network. They've removed anyone that was willing to challenge the powers that be, and they've put all of their stock in the Trump-supporting Joe Scarborough. The result is that the network has now become Fox News Lite, and they've proven that their corporate masters at Comcast are calling the shots. The problem is that when you have media outlets owned by corporate interests, every talking point that comes from that network is going to be to the benefit of those corporate interests. Free Speech TV does not take corporate money, and that's why your financial support is so important to us. Viewer voices and not corporate sponsors are what fuel Free Speech TV and drive many of our programming decisions. And you can help protect free speech today with your donation. Free Speech TV airs independent news and views for independent thinkers like yourself. Voices like Tom Hartman, Stephanie Miller, Bill Press, Amy Goodman, David Pakman, and us here at Ring of Fire have found a home at Free Speech TV. And we have some of the best educated and most informed viewers out there. And your contributions to Free Speech TV help to keep these voices on the air. Our programming equips our viewers with vital tools, resources, contacts, and examples of how to collectively build sustainable solutions to serious problems. Donate now and you can help bring these organizing tools into your community. Everyone should have access to news and information. Our goal is to keep you and everyone involved. And we aim to reach every viewer possible because we're all in this together. So please go online to freespeech.org and help support independent, honest news journalism. Your support helps to keep information flowing, and together we can hold the corporate media accountable. Not only is your donation tax deductible, but we also offer a few things in return. With a donation of $60, you will receive a Free Speech TV Stamp Stampede collaboration t-shirt. With a donation of $120, you will receive two Ring of Fire mugs and the Corporations Are Not People stamp. And with a pledge of $240, you'll get the Free Speech TV Stamp Stampede collaboration t-shirt, Jane Mayer's new book, Dark Money, The Hidden History of Billionaires Behind the Radical Right, and you'll get the Corporations Are Not People stamp. This is our first pledge drive of 2016, so let's make sure that we get off to a great start. The voices here on Free Speech TV are going to be more important than ever during the presidential election of 2016, and your donation today will help to make sure that these voices continue to be heard. We appreciate your support. And now, on to tonight's interviews. Corporations really do have all the luck. No other entity in this country could commit the kinds of crimes that corporations do and walk away without ever seeing the inside of a jail cell. There are two separate justice systems in this country, and the one for average citizens is far more harsh than the one that corporations live under. And I have Howard Nations with me now to talk about this. So, Howard, Senator Elizabeth Warren comes out with this great new report a couple weeks ago, Rigged Justice. I can't think of a more appropriate title for what's happening in the country today. Rigged Justice. The title says it all. I mean, that is exactly what's happening when you compare average citizens to corporate America. Lay this out for us.
Well, the sad fact is that equal justice under law is a cruel joke because of the inequitable enforcement and punishment of criminals. You hear the political mantra of, I'm going to be tough on crime, tough on crime. What does that really mean, especially when Republican politicians say it? It means tough on crime, it means tough on indigent defendants. It means tough on drug dealers, burglars, murderers, routine felons, as it should be. But it also means especially tough on black youth who are an easy target. What it does not mean is tough on corporate crime, tough on corporate executives who cheat and steal and destroy the jobs and life savings of citizens, as we saw in 2008, and then ravage the U.S. Treasury at taxpayers' expense. Corporate criminals proceed with impunity to rob America without fear of criminal prosecution.
And I think what's interesting, you know, needs to be pointed out is we say things like this a lot, but people have to understand this isn't just a talking point. It's not a hyperbole of, oh, you know, corporate America, they're so horrible, they're breaking the law left and right. I mean, this report lays out exactly what is happening. And it's true. I mean, you can go to almost any industry and find criminals sitting at the top. They've paid fines. They write most of those fines off in their taxes year to year. So they're screwing consumers twice. But I mean, we really have criminals out there running some of the biggest organizations, some of the biggest industries in America today.
Well, you know, the mythical purpose of law is of law enforcement is to punish wrongdoers, deter future criminality, and in some cases, to aid the victims. In a fair society, enforcement rules would be applied equally to both individuals and corporations accused of crime. Reality is that a black youth who possesses marijuana goes to prison, while a CEO who steals billions from American taxpayers pays a nominal fine and a substantial campaign contribution and returns laughingly to the same criminal pursuit he was doing before. This is what routinely passes for justice in America. Two high-profile recent events kind of reflect the broken system. Eric Garner was a black man who was accosted by four police officers for selling loose cigarettes on a New York street corner. He was summarily tried, convicted, and publicly executed in a matter of minutes. Now compare this to another event that happened on the streets of New York, Wall Street. Standard & Poor's credit rating paid a $1.375 billion civil settlement to the Department of Justice for the crime of defrauding investors by issuing inflated ratings that hid the credit risk of residential mortgage-backed securities. They were supposed to be one of the gatekeepers. They were the ones that could have stopped this before it happened. But this was their hiding it was one of the chief causes of the 2008 financial crisis that cost the economy trillions of dollars and resulted in the loss of homes, jobs, and life savings for literally millions of people. Now, how can you have $1 billion worth of criminal fraud with no crime? There were no charges against Standard & Poor's. No charges against anyone else on Wall Street among all the robber barons who pocketed billions of dollars at the expense of taxpayers. No one prosecuted for pillaging the U.S. Treasury.
And what's interesting is that the Department of Justice originally wanted six times that amount as part of a settlement and decided, okay, you know, we'll take one-sixth of what you actually caused in damages. So they get off basically free, because a lot of places, when you look at, you know, JP Morgan, Citigroup, Bank of America, when they pull off these massive crimes and they defraud consumers of billions of dollars, they then pay millions in fines. Yeah. They scammed you out of billions, and then they pay back millions. They not only not go to prison, they make a profit, and they don't have to give all of the money back. And that's one of the, I mean, that's almost as disgusting as nobody going to prison, is that they still keep the money that they stole. It's like somebody breaking into your home, stealing all of your belongings, getting caught by police and saying, all right, well, I'm going to give you one of your TVs back, and then we call it good.
And
this makes no sense.
Then we'll also give you a key to the house so you can go back in and do it again.
Yeah, exactly. So you know, there's so many more examples. You know, what else? I mean, what
well,
else are
the
these
question
people getting
is, away with? Why do we tolerate this? It's because we follow the golden rule of corporate America. He who has the goal makes the rules. We have wholly owned politicians of both parties who pay lip service to being tough on crime and equal justice under law, when in fact America imprisons more of our citizens than any other country in the world, while the corporate criminals enjoy the benefit of being in the upper 1% of wealth. Now, who's at fault for this? Mainly the enforcement agencies. The Department of Justice routinely settles corporate criminal cases with a fine of returning, as you say, a very small percentage. 1/6 is a pretty large recovery. 1/6 of what you steal is a pretty large recovery for the Department of Justice by their normal standards. They take a minimum nominal amount of money of what was stolen. They impose no criminal consequences and no incentives to repeat the crime. For example, if you look at the Education Mortgage Corporation, it's the second largest for-profit education company in the United States. They illegally paid recruiters to enroll students in violation of the False Claims Act. EDMC received $11 billion in payments, 90% by federal student loans and grants over an 8-year period. U.S. Department of Justice prosecuted and settled for $95 million, less than 1%. The DOJ did nothing for the students regarding student loans. They held no one individually accountable, no executive accountable. They required no admission of wrongdoing, which is important if the victims try to come in later and recover what they were defrauded out of. It's important that DOJ does not require an admission of wrongdoing. They did nothing to disqualify EDMC from coming right back and receiving federal funds in the future for doing the same thing. So this is how it works.
Well, and you know, a lot of the things we've talked about today and in the past typically revolve around the financial crimes, because those are some of the more serious, some of the more publicized. But we're also dealing with corporations out there, mining companies, automobile companies, where the result is not just stealing from consumers, but the result is death of consumers, yep. Death yep. of their workers. And, you know, so everyone needs to understand, you know, if you get stolen, get your income stolen from these companies, that is horrible. But when you look at what some of these other groups are doing, it could be a hell of a lot worse, because you may not even live to see the end of the day. I mean, GM's ignition switch failure, which is something, in my opinion, the media did not cover enough, even though they all talked about it, but they didn't go in depth enough. The fact that this ignition switch saved them maybe $2 per vehicle. $2! And people died because of it. To save $2 on your car, you it cost you your life. You are worth less than $2 to General Motors.
There were 124 deaths, and so far 275 injuries have been acknowledged. And you have to understand, this didn't come about as a result of any work. This cover-up of years and years of lying and covering this up did not come about as a result of investigation by the Department of Justice. It came about as a result of a lawsuit brought by a plaintiff's lawyer who got into discovery and found all this wrongdoing, then took that to the Department of Justice. And what happens when you hear about a multi-billion dollar recovery, a fine against big pharmaceutical companies, for example? It's not because any agency, any regulatory agency like the FDA, went out and found that they were doing wrong. It's because plaintiff's lawyers sued on behalf of injured plaintiffs that you see the TV advertising all the time for if you had this pill, that pill, and so forth. That type of thing leads to big litigation, which leads to the finding of wrongdoing, a lot of discovery, review of millions of pages of documents, and then the discovery of fraud, wrongdoing, and criminal activity that results in death and serious injury. And then after the plaintiffs finish the MDL, the Department of Justice comes in and says, oh, by the way, why don't we pick up $1 billion based upon the work done by the plaintiff's lawyers? So the regulatory agencies are completely failing. Even worse than that, the SEC, which is supposed to regulate this, they use their power to protect the corporate criminals because they have the power to give them waivers for collateral consequences. When the DOJ fines a corporation billions of dollars, or they settle for $1 billion or hundreds of millions of dollars, there are also supposed to be other consequences, not like not being able to do business with the federal government in the future. The SEC comes in and waives that so that they can go right back to doing the same thing. So there's a complete failure of the regulatory agencies in this matter.
Well, that's why the work that you do, the work that Mike Papantonio does and Michael Berg and David Haynes and everyone associated with the show, that's why it's so important. And Howard, I'm so grateful that we have people like you. We had just spoken, you know, before we talked today about how much work you have to do in the coming months. And it's that work that helps to keep consumers safe. And I hope everyone watching this appreciates everything that you and Pap and everyone else does, because you're the ones out there every day working to keep America safe for consumers. So, Howard, thank you for everything.
My pleasure, friend.
There have been more than 50 mass shootings in the United States in 2016, and we're still at the beginning of the month of March. And even with President Obama's recent executive action, it's still far too easy for people to get their hands on deadly weapons. And I have Elliot Feynman, the CEO of the Gun Victims Action Network, with me now to tell us what needs to happen to finally bring about some change in this country. So, Elliot, you recently wrote an op-ed where you talked about President Obama's executive action on gun order or gun control, background checks, where, you know, you said you applaud him for doing this, but it's not nearly enough. Explain that a little bit.
Well, it's not only not nearly enough. It would not be effective if everything that he was advocating actually came to pass. The main thing he wanted to do was to expand background checks. That was a big part of his executive order. But the reality is that the last 15 high-profile mass murderers all passed their background check. In other words, there's something inherently wrong with our background checks. And to simplify it, our background check should be as thorough as, say, what we do for someone adopting a child. That's one life, but it's held so preciously that people are interviewed personally, people who know the people are interviewed personally. In other words, it's not just a reference to a database that, in fact, when it's the gun database is missing millions and millions of records. 90% of the mental health records that should be in the database for background checks is not in. And we do these kind of background checks for machine guns, oddly enough. And when was the last time you read about a machine gun massacre? In other words, we're extremely careful. And these are how background checks are done in other countries, like England and France and Italy, et cetera.
Well, I think one thing that really interests me is the fact that a lot of people compare, you know, gun ownership to car ownership. Well, you're allowed to have a car. Why aren't you allowed to have a gun? But, I mean, we think about the fact that when we turn 16, we go get our driver's license. Before that, we had to have a learner's permit for 12 months. And then to even get this license to drive a car, because they are dangerous, we have to go through all these tests, a written test, a driving test. And yet, to get a gun that can kill people over and over and over and over again, you fill out paperwork and you just wait. I mean, there's a huge difference in these two, and there really shouldn't be.
You're absolutely right. And to take matters even further, there are several states now, Kansas the first, nine other states have lined up to do the same thing, where they do not require any training to have a gun. And on top of that, if you can believe this, they've passed laws that say you cannot pass a law to require training. Now, skip ahead. I mean, your point is so well made, and it's one that I talk of often when I have a chance to. They're talking about reciprocity in the Senate to begin with, and that would be that anybody who had a license to carry or a permit to carry or was allowed to carry in their state could be allowed to carry in your state. It would be like driver's license. If you had a driver's license in Kansas, you could use it in New York. The only difference is that with driver's licenses, there's kind of a uniform requirement. Everyone has to pass pretty much the same kind of test. They have to show proficiency in, you know, both the written and the actual doing of it. They have to carry insurance. In other words, you know, there's a uniform standard. But with the guns, how can you allow people, say, in New York, to come to New York, where New York has strict standards for who can carry, and they come from Kansas, where there's no standard for even training, and they could be allowed to carry? I mean, it's absurd. Well, it's really absurd.
You know, along those same lines, you know, I live along the Gulf Coast in Florida, and I have small children. If I wanted to take my small children with their little Mickey Mouse fishing pole, for them to even be able to cast that line into the water, I have to get them a fishing license. That's how stringent some of the laws are for a three-year-old to cast a line into the water. He has to have a license. It has to have his name, and I have to pay for that. But again, to get a gun, you fill out your paperwork, and you're good to go. I mean, we regulate so many things, some of them a little more, I guess, on the absurd side, but I understand it. And yet, when it comes to something as deadly as a firearm, it really, in this country, has become a free-for-all. And that's why we're at the point where we've had more than 50 mass shootings this year. The media is not necessarily talking about it anymore. We're all heated up in this presidential race, but we're averaging one every day and a half, every 36 hours in this country so far this year. How does this change? I mean, what do we do and where do we go from?
Well, I'm very glad you asked that question, because it's the exact question we struggled with and we really, you know, thought about. And we have a very precise answer. One is you must accept the reality that there's no way that Congress, the federal Congress, could pass a gun regulation. No way at all. And the reason is that the math doesn't work. You have 17 states, North Dakota, South Dakota, Wyoming, Montana, Arkansas, et cetera, that are so pro-gun, the NRA doesn't have to spend any money there. So right away, you have 34 senators, that's two from each of the 17 states, you have 34 senators that are opposed to any gun regulation. Now, in these days, you need 60 senators to pass something. So right away, you have 66 senators left. You wipe out the 34 that you're never going to get. So that means you've got to get 60 out of 66. It's not going to happen. The math just doesn't work. And if for any reason, but you know, my God, if for any reason you did by some, you know, stretch of reality get 60 senators to agree, you'd have to get it through the House and, you know, don't even think about it. So what we've said, you know, we've asked the question, well, what can be done? And we've come up with the answer. And the answer is that we're suffering, we're forced to live under a gun epidemic. There's a gun epidemic in our country. There's a provision in the law, the National Emergencies Act, whereby the president of the country has to declare a national state of emergency, whether it's man-made or natural, when the government, in the normal course of its activities, can't stop the epidemic. So that President Obama could, and we have a petition on our website, www.gunvictimsaction.org, it's right on the home page, where people can sign and say, we ask President Obama to declare a national state of emergency about the gun violence epidemic. Once he does that, unlike the executive orders that he issued, which were real, in my view, pablum, you know, they were like, well, okay, we could get these through, maybe. And of course, the other side isn't going to even give the maybe. But with a state of emergency, he doesn't need approval. He'll pass, and some of the laws he might pass, for example, would be to make trafficking a felony. If trafficking were a felony, that would stop the flow of guns into the inner city. He could make such things as he could lift the gun industry immunity from they're the only industry that has immunity for anything they do. Well, that would be lifted immediately. Doesn't need any discussion or, you know, that's it. Now that's the new law. You're not immune anymore. He would make parents responsible if their child took their gun and committed a crime with the gun. They would be held as accomplices, you know, for the same thing. He would make training mandatory. You know, there are all these sensible things that overnight would halt the gun violence epidemic. We're not talking about taking away people's guns, but we are talking about, as you said earlier, something rational, like, yes, we should have a database. We should know who has a gun. Just because you passed a background check and were sane, well, maybe it's 3 years later and you've had a breakdown and now you shouldn't have a gun. How do we know? Yeah. But we should be able to know. So what I always say is, if you look at our country and you compare it, say, to England or France or Italy or Germany or anyone you want to pick, Japan, etc., we have the same issues as they do. They have mentally ill people, they have criminals, they have gangs fighting over drug territory, they have injustice, they have poverty. We all have the same stuff. The one thing they don't have is gun violence. Well, why? Oh, maybe they have sensible gun laws. So, you know, it's as clear as day to me.
It absolutely is. And one of the issues, unfortunately, we're out of time, but just want to close on this. One of the issues is that it is in the Constitution, and Republicans and many Democrats want to believe that this document can't ever be changed, completely ignoring the fact that the Founding Fathers made it to be a changeable document. And so it is well within our power to do this. We just need strong leaders willing to stand up to the gun industry and say, look, things are horrible. They've got to change. Elliot Fineman, thank you for talking with us.
Thanks for having me. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news at our website, theringoffire.com. And you can get our daily podcast by going online to rofpodcast.com. And you can also subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftv. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.